I'm Eric Sandine. I direct the Wyoming Institute for Humanities Research, and we're sponsoring this lecture by Nelson Maldonado-Torres. I wanted to say a couple of words about the Research Institute before turning the podium over to Lilia Soto, who's going to introduce our speaker. The Research Institute has been in existence for almost 4 years now, and our goal is to promote faculty research, to create conversations among faculty, professional staff, and students. We had a very good conversation at noontime about diversity, which I'm still digesting, and also to take what the university has to offer in the way of humanities out into the state and interact with populations in the state who are really eager to talk about humanities issues, humanities values, humanities beliefs. This is a particularly critical time, I think, in the history of the humanities in Wyoming and also of the public humanities in the United States. So I think our role at the university and in the state has just gotten to be more important over the last several months. I also wanted to say that I'm not the only one, I'll have to be impolite and duck out of here right after the lecture, and I'm only announcing that because this gives me the moment to say that one of the graduates of our American Studies program, Adam Harris, is going to receive one of the governor's arts awards tonight, and I can't miss that as the director of that program for 32 years. So some of us in American Studies will be splitting, but that doesn't mean anything for you because you should stay here, you should talk, and you should have a question and answer session because this is a chance for us to talk about issues of diversity and the university and what's going on in the country. Lilia will help moderate that discussion. So without further ado, I'm going to turn the podium over to Lilia Soto, who is an assistant professor of American Studies and Latino Studies. Okay.
So I'm here to introduce Nelson Maldonado-Torres, who's an associate professor in the Department of Latino and Caribbean Studies and Comparative Literature Programs at Rutgers University, where he teaches courses in Caribbean political thought, literary theory, and Caribbean theorizing coloniality. He is interested in the crossings of different genealogies of thinking and their appearance in different genres of writing, discourse, artistic expression, and social movements. He has an extensive publication record, including his first book, Against War, Views from the Underside of Modernity, where he examines the basis of modernity coloniality in terms of a paradigm of war through the work of Enrique Dussel, Franz Fanon, and Emmanuel Levinas. His second book, La Descolonización y el Giro Descolonial, was published in 2011 by La Universidad de la Tierra in Chiapas, Mexico, and it is based on his essays on decolonial theory. He is also the co-editor of Latinos in the World System, Decolonization Struggles in the 21st Century U.S. Empire. He has also served as a guest editor on two special issues, Thinking Through the Decolonial Turn, Post-Colonial Interventions in Theory, Philosophy, and Critique in the Journal of Transmodernity. He is currently working on two book-length projects. The first one is called Fanonian Meditations, which aims to spell out the epistemological basis of ethnic studies and related areas, as well as examine the relevance of decolonization at the epistemological, ethical, and political levels, which continues the reflection on decolonial ethics and epistemology of his previous book. And the second book, Theorizing the Decolonial Turn, which provides a historical and theoretical overview of the decolonial turn. He has been the co-chair of religion in Latin American and the Caribbean group at the American Academy of Religion and has served in the board of the Hispanic group at the American Philosophical Association. He presided over the Caribbean Philosophical Association from 2008 to 2013, and is one of the organizers and signatories of the initiatives to create a Latino Academy of Arts and Sciences in the United States. He was also the director of the Center for Latino Policy Research at the University of California, Berkeley from 2009 to 2010, and chair of the Department of Latino and Hispanic Caribbean Studies at Rutgers from 2012 to 2015. Currently, he is a member of the executive board of the Franz Fanon Foundation in France, an honorary member of the Fausto Reynaga Foundation in Bolivia, and serves as book series co-editor of Critical Caribbean Studies at Rutgers University Press. And before I turn it over to him, I just wanted to say that when I was a graduate student at UC Berkeley, I had the privilege of auditing one of his courses, Radical Political Thought, and of being his graduate student instructor, which is a GA here, for a wonderful course required for undergraduate ethnic studies majors at UC Berkeley, and the course was called Humanities Methods in Ethnic Studies. And I have also had the pleasure of participating in decolonial seminar courses in Barcelona, in South Africa, and in Mexico City, where Nelson has lectured on decolonial thought, on art, on activism and theory, and the importance of ethnic studies. So please join me in welcoming Nelson Maldonado-Torres.
Thanks, Professor Soto, for the kind introduction, and thank you to Professor Eric Sandin, Director of the Institute for Humanities Research, without whose time, dedication, and commitment I would not be here. So really, thank you very much. And I hope to contribute to the space of reflection that you're opening through the Institute. And as a preface to my talk, thank you all for coming as well, Friday afternoon, no less. Especially the undergraduates, I suppose, but everybody who's looking to come back to their families, potentially have a nice Friday night, thank you for coming to the lecture. And as a preface to it, I have a video that we play for you. So the talk is... It's an expanded version of a short piece that the Franz Fanon Foundation loaded on its website. So if after the talk you want to revise some of the points, you can find a short version there. And so I will read most of it for the sake of time. It will probably be around 50 minutes. Responses to the results of the US presidential election in the US Academy have included the idea that the field of political science finally proved to be defunct because of the inability to predict the results, but also that the times call for more respect and support to areas such as philosophy and the humanities. You can understand the frustration of humanities scholars, particularly with democratic politicians, who contributed to defund universities and university programs during the last decade. These democratic leaders went to bed with neoliberalism, privatization of the public goods, and the introduction of the logic of the market into public arenas and public institutions, right? And helped to erode the humanities, which could be considered one key tool that would have alerted everyone to the problems of the Trump campaign even from earlier on. This narrative about the humanities is tempting and there is some truth to it, but it is still too simplistic. So in what follows, I will share what is admittedly some tough love for the humanities as someone trained primarily in them and as someone invested in many of the tools that are found in them. Even before the election, when the toxic environment of the campaign was already severe and all-pervasive, the philosopher John McComber published a commentary in the Chronicle of Higher Education. This was a month before the election, entitled, quote unquote, "How Humanities Can Help Fix the World." The commentary starts by noting that the two main arguments in defense of the humanities, namely, that it makes life worth living and that it provides useful skills for jobs, are not working anymore. So McComber posits the thesis that the humanities can fix the world. By this, he means that courses like history and sociology, and he includes sociology in the mix, so in a way, he's also including the humanistic social sciences or even the entire range of the social sciences, can teach students that evil discourses such as anti-Semitism are what evil discourses social anti-Semitism are, that is a proper definition of them, and also how to avoid them. He writes that, and I quote, in particular, it is the humanities that teach us how not to be racists by showing us how to open ourselves up to what is different. He adds that, I continue quoting, whether a given humanist is a modernist, postmodernist, neocritic, Marxist, or an adherent of any of dozens of other approaches, what she does in the classroom is always the same. She takes some cultural product that seems at first strange and off-putting, a poem by some ancient Greek or Persian poet, a novel by some African or Chinese author, a statue from an indigenous culture whose true name we don't even know, and if she's a good teacher, makes it familiar enough to be interesting. Doing that inevitably expands the minds of the students, bringing their horizons just a little closer to the widest horizons of all, those of humanity itself, close quote. McComber does not mention the heavy doses of racism and sexism in the election campaign and the size and nature of Trump rallies in his piece, even though he published this in October. However, a few days after the election, two other philosophers, this time younger folks, assistant professors, did precisely this in a column with the title, Donald Trump's Victory Shows Why We Need Philosophy Students More Than Ever. The authors embraced the slogan, Make America Think Again, and they cite Plato's Socratic dialogues and the Socratic method as a form of education that urges, quote, teachers in a democratic society to be rigorous and vigilant in pushing for critical reflection on all views, including our own. For me, the second piece by the younger philosophers speaks and reveals more openly the limits of the first piece. McComber, the author of the first piece, making the case for the humanities as a form of teaching that fixes the world, writes as if the dozens of approaches that one finds in the humanities and the wide variety of cultural products that are studied in the humanities appear in a horizontal plane of equality where they are all democratically selected by the teacher. Of course, neither theoretical approaches nor cultural objects exist in such horizontal plane, and much less they are democratically selected in departments by teachers. Also, the very humanities that McComber praises with facilitating the understanding of the strange are the ones that are largely responsible for creating and sustaining the logic that separates theoretical approaches and cultural products along vertical and hierarchical lines. Ultimately, the color line is not something that we find out there in societies also, that is found right in the university and right at the heart of the humanities. Additionally, the means, the criteria, and the terms by which humanities teachers make a strange familiar, make the strange familiar enough to be interesting. And I am having issues with all these categories, the familiar, the interesting, as the solutions to what we're facing, are also extremely loaded and work as much to illuminate as to hide aspects that will never become simply familiar to the standard student or citizen subject. In truth, issues such as racism and anti-Semitism, if studied rigorously, can never simply become interesting and familiar. They are disturbing, shocking, and their consideration shackles the peace and comfort of the modern subject, which is why there are multiple modalities of evasion in order to safeguard the integrity of the citizen and modern subject, and so that the student can also feel comfortable with that material. The humanities have been crucial in producing and preserving these forms of evasion. I therefore submit that one has to engage in a serious and rigorous critique of the humanities before one is able to find what is that they have to offer to fix the world, if anything. Also, one cannot assume that what will come out of this result of reflection will necessarily be called or should be called the humanities, even if strategically speaking, it is a name that continues to be used. That is, we often in the academy criticize, for example, identity politics and people engaged in identity politics because they can only see and understand the world through the value of a label. But sometimes we humanists are reproduce the worst of the worst kind of identity politics because we defend the humanities in face of the market logic and neoliberal value and so on. But everything has to be at the end, it is the humanities and the humanities alone. And so we die when we consider that what we may come out of a critical examination of it may not be something that we would call the humanities anymore. And I think in that we need to engage in a critique of the humanities with that openness, not with the idea that we're going to safely land in our humanities once again. The call to pursue a thorough critique of the humanities becomes evident when one considers the irony that while the above-mentioned philosophers argue for the relevance of the humanities and of philosophy in face of the avalanche of racism, sexism, and anti-immigrant rhetoric in the Trump campaign, when it comes to issues like diversity, the demographic of the philosophy departments is as bad or worse as the demographic of Trump supporters and the Republican Party. This is not unique to philosophy, though. The picture doesn't get much better when you go to the actual bibliography and content that philosophers teach in philosophy departments or that humanists teach, typically. Or the theoretical approaches used to make philosophical topics familiar to students. What are the tools through which you're making the unfamiliar familiar? And why is it that the familiar looks familiar at the end? It may not be because already the theoretical tools are already part of an order that is familiar to the students. So in making them challenging, is challenging them somewhat. That is probably why just a few days after the election, the young philosophers could not but focus their entire argument about the relevance of philosophy on Plato's contributions to pedagogy. There is a long record of considering the cultural production of people of color as objects to be seen through white theoretical lenses. As Lewis Gordon has pointed out, blacks are seen as providing experience while whites provide theory. The additional great irony is that, if anything, what became clear after the elections was that all liberal defenses of the humanities, defenses that emerge in the context of saving the humanities from the onslaught of neoliberalism, not that emerged for the first time there, but came back in a very strong way, may have been utterly misguided from the beginning. And that additionally, the fields that clearly showed their relevance in the context of the elections were not the traditional humanities disciplines, but rather the areas that thoroughly resisted the idea that we had reached some kind of post-racial panacea and that the humanities were best prepared to lead us through it. These other areas happen to be the fields that have historically been overwhelmingly sidelined and considered redundant and excessive in the university. I am referring to fields such as ethnic studies areas, particularly those that focus on systematic forms of dehumanization in the United States, African American and African studies, Asian American and Pacific Islander studies, Chicano, Puerto Rican and Latino studies, and Latina studies, Native American and hemispheric indigenous studies. And my argument here is not that these areas have to be better included, it's not a plea for recognition that they have to be better included in the humanities or the liberal arts, but rather that these are fields through which the liberal arts and the humanities can go through to engage in a process of transformation and decolonization. Also, out of this decolonization, what we'll get is not the humanities necessarily, but a transdisciplinary and decolonial form of knowledge formation that is substantially anti-racist and that breaks the division between scholarly work, theory, the arts, and strategic activist work. This is also a form of knowledge that may not be able to confine or codify within an institution such as the Western University. Yonela Butler has talked about this in terms of conceiving ethnic studies and related fields as a matrix for the transformation of the humanities and social sciences. I am not the first to point out the failure of the humanities that has become more transparent in the recent context. In 2015, the prominent race theorist George Lipsis, also an ethnic studies scholar, and also Professor Lilia Soto's mentor, one of her mentors, made similar points in a presentation that he offered at Princeton University. The title of Lipsis' talk was, and this is 2015, Ferguson as Failure of the Humanities. In the presentation, Lipsis discussed, and I quote, how Ferguson not only demonstrates a failure of the criminal justice system, the political system, and the economic system, but it also illuminates a grievous failure of the humanities, the realm of knowledge devoted to promoting judgment, discernment, and empathy to envision a creative common existence has instead generated methods of evasion, denial, and disavowal grounded in methodological individualism, hostile privatism, and fear-laden fantasies of the dehumanized other. Close quote. For someone who shares a similar point of view about the humanities, who has been in ethnic studies for a long time, and who immediately sensed that the humanities and the liberal arts were involved, partly responsible even in the election results, because their general investment on post-racialism and tranquility next to post-racial logics, right? And comfort next to post-racial logics. And also, because the humanities' general investment on post-racialism and on completely ineffective diversity and inclusion initiatives, you can imagine how surprising it was for me to read yet more defenses of the humanities in the same vein as always, in October and November of 2016. At that moment, I could not contain myself. The attempt was so utterly ridiculous, offensive, and short-sighted that I could only read those columns as curiosities, and to some extent, performances of whiteness. And that is where I think that Dave Chappelle, in that skit, hit the nail on his head with the sketch, where he and Chris Rock laugh hysterically at white liberals in denial and thinking that that's the end of the world and so on and so forth, right? That's the vision. I felt like that when I'm reading these columns about the humanities, right? So in the same school, in the academy. So I would dare to say that many, if not most, of us faculty of color in institutions of higher learning feel like Dave Chappelle and Chris Rock on that skit, where they hang out with white friends in election night. The difference is that we cannot afford to laugh because the university space is not as unforgiving as their nice living room where they hang out with their white friends. We live in a context where our contributions and the fields that have so prominently called for attention to the significance of racism, sexism, and multiple other forms of structural inequality and phobias keep being ignored and in many cases are aggressively limited and shut down, while white academics share in the scandal of discovering that the country is racist, that race counted for so much, or that people seem to easily disregard racism and the threat of multiple communities as long as they are promised better economic conditions. Of course, better economic conditions alone is not solely what many of them want, right? Claiming their country back. At the same time, the very same academics tend to remain blind to the racism, sexism, and structures of inequality and phobias that they perpetrate and that are constitutive of the academy itself. I'm not saying that everything we do or should do is laugh, right? Should be laughing at this. But I'm thinking that there is something crucial about laughing and that laughing even has a theoretical import. There's some lesson about why that reaction that time. And I'm not the first one to think about this either. For example, the report that the eminent African American theorist, intellectual author W.E.B. Du Bois submits when he listened to, I would say, liberals approaching him with statements such as, "I know an excellent colored man in my town." Right? This is 1903, for example, you know, the late 19th century, early 20th century. And you're a black intellectual and someone sees you. And the one thing that they can say when they're approaching you is, and I'm quoting from his book, Souls of Black Folk, I know an excellent color man in my town. And you're like, what? What the hell? Why are you saying that? He tells us two things. I mean, he analyzes this situation. First, that more than a statement, this statement, I know an excellent color man in my town, more than a statement the person was making is a question, and that question was, do boys posit, how does it feel to be a problem? How does it feel to be a problem? That's really what the person is trying to is getting at. With this, Du Bois reveals the racial subject as a theoretical or semiological machine. That is, you are always seeing behind the surface and uncovering meaning that is usually inaccessible. For the racialized subject, it is not history and sociology or the humanities that educates her or him like this, even though they could offer tools that contribute to this effort. It is rather the very precarious position of constant assailant, being constantly assailed, and the vulnerability that generate what Du Bois call a second sight, and what Gloria and Saldúa refer to as la facultad. You're beginning to the faculty, seeing what is behind the surface that makes you even more vulnerable because you begin to read all the scenes of potential vulnerability. It's a form of survival, of course. So that's the first point that we learn with Du Bois, that the racial subject already, by being exposed to this situation, there are mechanisms that generate semiological and interpretive and theoretical capacities and tools that allow this subject to better grapple with that situation and have better chances of surviving. And in the case if the subject mobilizes in the effort to change society, then you have more tools because you know you can read the structures of power better. So that's one thing. So the racialized subject is not some inert object or victim right there. Right? It's a productive theorizing consciousness. And the second point is that to this statement, question, how does it feel to be a problem? Du Bois said that he seldom responded other than with silence or with a smile. Who knew that one little smile from Du Bois would capture so much? So there is the moment in Du Bois of responding with a smile. In the source of Black Folk is where he is now, putting the meaning, everything, explaining the performance, explaining everything in word, right? In the written word. But usually as it goes, he used the smile. So I begin to think about, well, this is the smile, means this, and there is the hysterical laugh that we began to see here. They mix, you know, they're surely connected. And Du Bois is not the only one who observes this. Franz Fanon, right at the beginning of the chapter 5 of Black Skin, White Mask, on the lived experience of the black, narrates an experience of a black subject being identified by a kid, a child, who says to his mother, look a Negro, mama. Look a Negro, mama. And he narrates the number of reactions that emerge in relation to that moment. And one of the first one is a smile. Now, in that moment, he shows the situation doesn't stop there. The kid persists. Look, the Negro mama is here. And then the mother is trying to keep him quiet, but it keeps into the scene. And it's clear the mother is not continuing the situation until at the end he says something to the effect, kiss these handsome Negro or Negroes as madame. And then he says, with this, the terrain of fight has been marked, right? The struggle. And then the chapter begins another. Now, something interesting about that chapter is that it begins, the first line is, dirty nigger or look a Negro. Right? Meaning, look a Negro is like the more positivistic kind of a statement. You're identifying a body. It seems with that coldness of the distance, look a Negro. But ultimately what he's saying is underneath that, it's like the statement that Du Bois found, right? That this having to say that at that moment and only meet something else. And for him, ultimately, that apparent neutral moment is deeply racist, is showing a deeply racist attitude. So what I'm saying is that I think something similar holds with what is happening in the sketch. And also, that's how I began to understand even the import of my reaction to these columns that I found. So let me say a little bit about the US elections and race. There is no doubt that there is not a single interpretation that explains the outcome of the US elections. But no one can hide the prominent role that racism and xenophobia had in generating enthusiasm for the candidacy of Donald Trump. Since the very moment when he descended an escalator to announce that he was going to run for president, up until the presidential debates, Trump kept linking illegal immigrants with violence, murder, and rape. Trump also aimed to subvert the narrative of Black Lives Matter on its head, where African-American activists call attention to the problems caused by police violence, bias in the exercise of the law, and the prison industrial complex. Trump made it appear that, quote unquote, illegal immigrants, Muslims, refugees, and black ghettos represented the principal cause of concern in contemporary US society. In this picture, Black Lives Matter was part of the problem, instead of a movement helping us to identify the problem. Cornel West refers to this as a lethal, to the support to Trump, a lethal fusion of economic insecurity and cultural scapegoating. And he writes that it brought neoliberalism to its knees. But I would add that it didn't really bring neoliberalism to its knees, rather it brought a presumably cosmopolitan form of neoliberalism to its knees, one with open borders, for example, giving way to a nationalistic neoliberalism. A nationalistic neoliberalism, right? You want privacy, you want free market, and so on, but at the same time, you want the borders protected and the nation protected. So we need to seriously investigate the links between nationalistic neoliberalism, and that is national neoliberalism and national socialism, both forms of fascism. Or maybe we can call national neoliberalism a form of neo-fascism. Consider Hitler's characterization of national socialism. This is Hitler. From the camp of bourgeois tradition, it takes about national socialism, national resolve, and from the materialism of the Marxist dogma, it takes living creative socialism, combining. So national liberalism, I would say that it takes from republican conservatism, national resolve, and from neoliberalism, it takes living and creative privatization and the true freedom of the market. But national neoliberalism is not the only political ideology to be connected with fascism. In 1933, the Jewish philosopher Emmanuel Levinas wrote an essay on the philosophy of Hitlerism, where he pointed to important parallels between liberalism and fascism. Not neoliberalism, liberalism and fascism. And I think that it was this continuity between liberalism and fascism that is partly responsible for the liberal enchantment with post-racialism, which by declaring racism fundamentally over becomes complicit with its propagation. And just like liberalism was not able to produce the opposition to fascism in the early 1930s, but if anything contributed to it, so the liberalism of the Cold War and the later part of the 20th century did not counter, but actually led to the neo-fascism of neoliberal nationalism or national neoliberalism. And so the question for us is, what has been the role of the humanities, which are so critical to liberalism and to the whole idea of the liberal arts in this connection? Where if liberalism helped to preserve a context that what emerged at one moment as national socialism could come back as national neoliberalism liberalism together. So I'm thinking of a trio in the 20th, 21st century political slash economic ideologies that maybe we can study together. Coming back to Trump. Trump had already obtained credit among everyone who shared his view of the fundamental problems in the country by his challenge to President Obama's legitimacy on the basis that he was a foreigner. In a political career, remember asking for the birth certificate? In a political career that started with the depiction of the first black president as a foreigner, it was consistent that ethno-racial foreigners would be represented as the overwhelming problem that a Trump presidency will seek to address later. These discursive strategies would not have worked if there were not sectors in the population that did not identify with them. If a centrist black president raised so much anxiety and hate that some did not consider his presidency legitimate, one can only imagine the effect of a discourse such as Black Lives Matter, which is not focused on seeking representation in the established spheres of power, but rather on challenging the established structure itself, particularly the law and order regime in the US. Black Lives Matter turned what was already an intolerable situation for white supremacists into their worst nightmare, because now it's not only an elegant, well-spoken African-American man in the presidency trying to play nice and trying to serve as the neutral arbiter. Now we're talking about a social movement now seeking, pointing even the state force, the force of the state, the police, as a fundamental problem, and even the institutions of justice. Right? So all of this, and you know, you have to also see the irony between the first African-American president is in that context that you find this massive wave of acts of violence towards African Americans to the point that this new movement emerged, right at that moment, right? In response, Trump vilified vulnerable sectors of society while presenting himself as the law and order candidate. He used that phrase. Trump was doing a service not only to white nationalists, but to a structure of white supremacy. And there was someone who has said that Trump was elected to protect white supremacy, precisely. In turn, he was shielded and protected by white supremacy and economic insecurity and cultural scapegoating to the point that, as Trump himself admitted, he thought that he could shoot someone and still not lose voters. That his candidacy remained alive and that he won the election after multiple accusations of the crudest forms of misogyny and a confession of assault all but confirmed this impression. Right, that he would not lose voters. So imagine how shielded was he. Imagine if Obama would have done one tiny portion of those things. That college graduates tended to support Hillary Clinton in the election does not mean that higher education prepared them well to counter the logic and reality that Trump represents. It only suffices to hear the complaints of students of color in universities, to look at the lack of racial diversity in university departments, and to note the lack of support to units that focus on the critical study of racism, sexism, and related structural inequalities and phobias, to understand that universities are an extension of the very social world that academics often aim to criticize. If anything, graduates, university graduates, come out of college well prepared to leave in a world that adopts a post-racial rhetoric while it reproduces racial hierarchies. But both this rhetoric and this tolerance of racial hierarchies make college graduates and academics ill-prepared to counter what is at the root of Trump's success, white supremacy and anti-blackness. Needless to say, Clinton's election would not have represented a challenge to this order in the academy either. Instead, it would have likely continued a discourse of post-racialism in universities. And that's why then the whites in the rooms would have been happy. For the most part, since the election of Barack Obama, up until perhaps the emergence of Black Lives Matter, there arguably was an increasing trend to consider US society as post-racial. The presence of a black president confirmed the post-racial feelings of many. Even when Black Lives Matter emerged, one could hear and can still hear attempts at correction from the presumably universalist and humanist perspectives of the arts and sciences with the competing motto, all lives matter. This is not only an example of missing the point, but also an effort to continue imposing a framework that always renders racial issues secondary and residual. Also, as Kianga Yamata Taylor has pointed out, in a way she says that Barack Obama's original sin was precisely America's post-racial illusion. So my argument here is that the liberal investment, and generally speaking, the humanities investment in post-racialism render generations of us unable and unequipped to really be able to diagnose, analyze, and counter this logic from the Tea Party to now. Because we are deploying every time post-racial rhetoric of tolerance and progressive liberalism to counter something fundamental that went largely mistakenly theorized and unrecognized, but that these fields like ethnic studies, African studies, and so on, were all the time pointing to the problems. But inside the university, they were being pushed down. Right. Now, just a quick note to say, and I'm going to jump this section, that this affinity of the humanities with liberalism and with post-racialism, that goes deep. This is not only a 20th century phenomenon. That it goes, I think, to the heart of the very definition of the humanities as grounded in the Latin concept of humanitas, as opposed to the Greek concept for the human, which was anthropos. Right? And this is a contribution that Osamu Nishitani makes, that ultimately the humanities are grounded on the primacy of humanitas. But the issue is that not everyone in the planet was considered worthy of belonging to humanitas, larger part of the planet, particularly in the colonial territories. That's why they were colonial territories and people enslaved without any problem, because they did not were seen as belonging to the same category to begin with. They belonged to another category of another kind of human that later became anthropos, and from their anthropology as the science that studies certain subjects and cultures as objects, but never as subjects. So this goes back to the very emergence, to the Renaissance, to the European Renaissance, and to the long 16th century. So you have a development of the three categories of humanitas, anthropos, but also the category of the damné, like in Brecher, the damné, like in Franz Fanon classic, Le damné de la terre, the damned of the earth. I think it's another category that is needed to understand how the concept of the human was bifurcated. And that's why the humanities have never been effective, because they have kept they have been located in the realm of humanitas, which is already extremely delimited. And the mission has been gradually, they have been forced to accept more elements from anthropos into the humanitas. But the point I'm making is that decolonization is not about inclusion into an already made idea. It's about more radical revision and rethinking. And that's where the liberal subject and the humanities scholar will typically put the line, right, in an identitarian form. Beyond post-racialism, how to go beyond it? And here, I'm going to also jump part of this and go to a discussion of the effort to defend universities as sanctuary spaces. If there are areas of study that deserve more attention after the elections, they are the fields that were at the forefront of critiquing and opposing the extremely and largely intentional, slow and ineffective post-racial script of diversity and inclusion all along. Namely critical, intersectional, and decolonial ethnic studies fields, as well as women and gender studies, when not focused on whiteness. Support of these areas may represent the most direct and firm challenge to the current neo-fascist trend in society and to the liberal post-racialism in the academy. They are also the areas that are best prepared to equip students to critically analyze and oppose fascist, racist, and dehumanizing tendencies in all their forms, including liberal forms. This includes not only the theoretical tools and multiple research projects, but also their attention to pedagogies that challenge the walls of separation between our campuses and the communities that surround them. The critical and intersectional tools and pedagogies developed in the colonial ethnic studies and women and gender studies programs allow us to see, for example, that while calls for making university campuses sanctuaries for the undocumented are extremely valuable today, our campuses have never offered a consistently safe space for students or communities of color, whether they have papers or not. Even faculty of color are treated as threatening outsiders sometimes. And students of color take on the added responsibility of reaching out to their communities, while their overall time for studying is reduced by added hours of work. Universities cannot become real sanctuaries for people of color as long as what they consider sanctum continues to be, or holy, continues to be premised on our secondary status of people of color. If not, the expectation of our disappearance and the mere inclusion of our colorship in the very same fields and structures that have denied those issues that we focus on for so long. We will not go far if we fail to confront the reality that the liberal arts and sciences themselves, not neo-fascist ideologues, are responsible for all this. Likewise, our efforts to address and counter the racist forces that are becoming so obvious today, but that have been dominant all along, will be undercut if calls for increasing the number of sanctuaries for the undocumented collapse into the affirmation of discourses and practices of inclusion instead of becoming part of the struggle for decolonization. The opposite of exclusion in context structured by coloniality is not inclusion, but decolonization. Inclusion in this context is just another form of coloniality. Long before Trump promised a wall, universities have been increasing their disconnection with their surrounding communities and making it more difficult for those communities to consider universities not only accessible, but also relevant. University policies of quote-unquote diversity and inclusion and the increasing disconnect of universities from communities contributed to failing in the effort to produce a kind of a student body and scholars who would stand up, who would have stood up to the neoliberal and neo-fascist challenges of the time earlier. In this context, neither rejecting the vulgar racism and sexism of the Trump campaign, nor voting for Clinton, nor joining campaigns to increase the number of sanctuaries for the undocumented, assume the depth and weight of the challenge. The struggle is against racial liberalism, racial slash national neoliberalism, white supremacy, sexism, heteronormativity, and neo-fascism combined, all of which represent a challenge to excellence in knowledge production, not to mention a threat to historically disenfranchised communities, among others. For this reason, as much as calls to secure college campuses as sanctuaries for the undocumented are important, the real challenge for white academics and those who share the perspectives that seem to be most dominant among them is not so much joining these campaigns, but becoming part of the struggle to decolonize the university. And actually, this is not a concept that I'm inventing or a movement that I'm inventing. This being movement that has been alive for generations now and that is extremely active now in South Africa. But it has long roots in the US. That, I anticipate, will be much more difficult to all of them. To be sure, this does not mean that there should not be efforts to bring different sectors together in favor of the sanctuaries, but only that, A, we cannot allow this to cause this cause to become yet another means of strengthening post-racialism, liberal inclusion, and the redemption without reparations of whiteness, And B, this is only part of the larger struggle that includes the desegregation and decolonization of the university. In conclusion, the times call not for yet another round of self-congratulatory efforts from scholars in the humanities and the humanistic social sciences or the liberal arts and sciences in general, who aim to save their units in a context of austerity and now moral outrage, but for a serious reflection on the entanglement of all these areas with the order of knowledge being and power that naturalizes race and other forms of structural inequalities and phobias. Likewise, the current moment provides yet another opportunity for academics to learn from and support the most rigorous and consistent anti-racist, anti-sexist, and decolonial scholarship and pedagogy there is, found in ethnic studies, women and gender studies, as well as in sexuality studies fields. This is a moment to identify and develop new strategies of transformation beyond diversity and inclusion initiatives. Here is an opportunity to break from the spell of academic liberalism and to support the kind of research that has always identified the limits of post-racial discourses in the academy. Administrators will unlikely find more direct legal means. Administrators will unlikely find more direct legal means of opposing the neo-fascist trends than by aggressively supporting ethnic studies and related areas that have a substantial record of producing critical, intersectional, and decolonial scholarship. I have another paragraph where I speak about the fact that this idea that creating more committees, you know, committees to try to understand where the problems are and so on continues, right? The continued production of committees and ad hoc committees to keep producing reports that never get anything substantial, and if they do something, it disappears in 3 years and the committees return again. It's like the eternal returns of the committees to address issues about, you know, the lack of diversity, racial discrimination, and so on. That is now with what is happening now. Should be a wake-up call, no more committees, actual action. And the action is clear. You want to piss off Trump, you want to piss off those who put in power, then give support to the areas that you have pushed aside for so long. Right? African studies, African American studies, ethnic studies in these areas, and allow them to become an engine of transformation for different areas to find their mission and their goal today. So I also think that scholars in the humanities will unlikely find better opportunities to break away from the long legacy of complicity with liberalism and other even more lethal political ideologies, such as what we are seeing right now in this country. I think it was 50 minutes. Thank you.
Questions?
Particularly for those of us who are very clearly of colonial descent and plan on going on to doctoral programs in the humanities, what are some ways that we must hold not only ourselves but our advisors accountable in order to honor the necessity of decolonizing these fields? Because it's going to be especially important for us to do a lot of emotional labor that we have thus far not done.
Before we go, I mean, maybe we should take a couple of questions, but just this one I think deserves an immediate quick response, and then I can elaborate later, and everyone can elaborate. I mean, this is a question, it's a very fundamental question, very important. And actually I think that what I would say initially is, how do you hold them accountable and how can you participate in that project of advancing decolonization? Keep asking questions like that with that clarity. And with that sense of time, right? Now that you're going, right? Every stage of the way, you bring up honest questions, profound questions that bring up the complexity of what the task is in front of us. And you put them there. That by itself, that is one thing that you can do among so many others, instead of being silent, or instead of presuming that you're going to get the questions. So keep these concerns as sources for questions throughout.
I was very engaged when you said that the opposite of exclusion is not inclusion, but decoloniality. I thought it was a way of phrasing that I found fascinating. But then when I thought about it at an institutional level, I don't see what the difference is. So I guess my question would be if you could help me or perhaps us understand at a real institutional level what the difference or the similarities between decolonizing and working towards inclusion.
Just to respond to you, I don't think that you got the framing right. As I understood it, the opposite of colonialization is not inclusion, it's decolonization. So I didn't hear the word exclusion in that.
No, I had it there. Yeah, well, thank you.
Okay, any other questions for this round? Margarita?
Thank you so much for being here, Nelson, and thank you, for having this space. So decolonization, and I just think that the United States still has Puerto Rico as a colony, a territory, and so how, I teach that as Latino and Latino studies, you know, in English in my departments, and so how can I decolonize or have that within the United States, and what is Trump going to do with that territory?
There is, maybe that's, there is a meme that is like, Pence telling Trump something like, oh, I check and we can actually deport the Puerto Ricans, something like that. Because Puerto Ricans are US citizens, right? Already. But let me see, the first question and the question about decolonization and inclusion are related. Because you're asking what are strategies as a graduate student, and I would say white or non-white to advance the decolonization, and so how is different from inclusion. Well, the phrase was something like this, that the opposite of exclusion in a context defined by coloniality is decoloniality, right? It's not inclusion. And let me give you couple of examples. When the Third World Strike started at UC Berkeley and San Francisco State, the students were, you know, students inspired by Third World Revolutions in different parts of the world, and they were demanding the creation of a Third World College. That is not to be part of the College of Arts and Sciences, right, or to the College of the Humanities, but to have a new college, which will have its own dean, which will have its own criteria for admission, that will have its own way of relating with the community, that it will define the pedagogy in the ways that it thought proper, right? That it will not have to be negotiating with people specialized in history or literature, how they thought that we should produce knowledge, this or that, right? They were claiming the space to do something, an epistemic pedagogical project grounded of the experience of the political education that they were gotten in that revolutionary moment. And for them, that could not be more different than the traditional disciplines and degrees, right? In a way, when they went to the traditional history and English and so on, they felt disciplined into a specific perspectives that did not allow them to grow or even to engage the readings and materials they were doing, right? So what the university did is, that for me was a proposal to decolonization. Even still within on the university board, where they were demanding to open up, to allow for the creation of a new set of criteria for the definition of excellence and for the production of knowledge, right? Even to the admissions. The university translated that, and this is where inclusion comes. Well, maybe we can do maybe a college, but it won't be a third world college, it would be a college of ethnic studies. Actually, the nomenclature ethnic studies was based on the notion that there were already area studies. Area studies, you focus on different areas of the world. So they said it makes sense for the university. Well, perhaps we can justify this. There is already these, you know, Latin American studies, African studies, Middle Eastern studies. So maybe like that we can have at the national level Latino studies or Chicano studies and, you know, and African American studies. That's how they translated it. That's how they included them into the university. The actual demand when the students wanted to do was something quite radically different. The name indicated the transition. Right? So they come. At Berkeley, because the stakes are higher, because it's sort of the perhaps the most prestigious campus on the in the California state system, they would not go as far even to create a college. They created the College of Ethnic Studies in San Francisco State University, right? Which is in the hierarchy of the state system, right? Right, is in a way between the community college and the university. So it's in between the state university. They will create a college there, but they will create only a department of ethnic studies. And they created everything that the college was supposed to have. Not only they reduce third world to ethnic studies, but department to college. Right? And from there, the history of 40, more than 40 years now of that department has been the university trying to include it into, the, make it work. And how is that for them? Integrate them ultimately into the College of Arts and Sciences, right? Into the humanities, which actually ultimately they did through divide and rule. There is a long story. They ultimately did. They enter. And now what happens? That if you're a professor of ethnic studies, right? Who, you know, more time than not is the dean of the unit that you have to report to as a chair of the department, as a faculty. Your tenure process, who defines the merit, is the same college that defines it for the historian, the traditional historian, for the traditional, you know, literature person, and so on. And they come with those criteria to evaluate the intellectual and pedagogical production of everyone in that department. And, I mean, then the department wanted to create, you know, they accepted it. They said, strategically, let's use this. They said, well, ethnic studies should not be only a department that students could, in which students can take classes, but it should be a requirement. You know, every student should take something like ethnic studies requirement, right? That is, they're already working within the compromise form that is the concept of ethnic studies. And the university says, you know, the push, this is the 80s, there is the whole culture wars going on. And they say, well, after the struggle led by faculty and students, they say, well, okay, but we're going to call it the American cultures requirement. And then you see from third world to ethnic studies, to American cultures, and so on and so forth. And so usually, more often than not, the logic of inclusion, when you talk about inclusion, there is already some normative space that is going to be doing the including, and the terms of which will be unchangeable, right? That your criteria of excellence will still operate, and the inclusion is giving you opportunities to demonstrate that you can fit into X thing. But maybe X thing, X factor is what you're questioning, right? And so at that moment is that they use the different elements. They bring you into these houses, this college, and so on, so that the policing elements of those schools work. And so decolonization, a real and honest effort for decolonization will go in completely different ways. Not presume that the humanities or the liberal arts and sciences already provide the criteria of excellence that best define what is, or the criteria, the merit of the criteria that best define what is excellent knowledge. Right? That is, you will put, you would allow for much more experimentation, and also you would allow for subjects. You know, usually when it comes to people of color, the idea is that, well, they don't have this preparation to lead, so they always have to follow, because the criteria is already defined in a way that only some people are going to be recognized as the natural leaders. But decolonization is to recognize also different forms of expertise and experience so that you allow other principles of organization to begin to play out. The university, as we know it to date, even this liberal, post-racial humanities and social sciences, they also have their history, and they were born out of experimentation. The Renaissance humanists, it's not that everything came down. You know, those were experimentation. They claim it, they got support until they pushed theology out of the places where theology was dominant And in the US it's so clear that the Ivy League now, right, they were religious schools at the start. But there was an epistemology, an insurgency, let's say, and push the theologian schools out, and now you have to go to specialized divinity school to do that. That very framework that pushed theology, pushed God out of the, is the one that keeps anthropos in the position. And it's the one that is keeping only the logic of inclusion, that is filtering only to the extent that we can understand it, only to the extent that we can translate it into readable sociology or readable history or readable political science. So that's typically the logic of inclusion. That's why I say it's a logic of it's an attempt to assimilation, more than a real attempt to radical opening and so on and so forth. And you have other instances of other administrators and academics that are much more creative in the way that they use the classroom or what they try to open. I have been in contexts where administrators are more administrators that usually are demonized by, you know, faculty because you are being taken by neoliberalism and privatization and all these interests. I have found administrators that are much more progressive and willing to endorse logics as decolonization. And the ones who oppose that logic are the liberal faculty because they are protecting the integrity of their disciplines and their fields. And they will not allow anything to happen in the university if it's not recognized according to the codes that they already recognize. So in that way, decolonization can come from different places. And I would say that more than the administrators is sometimes the faculty, ourselves, department chairs, people, when it comes to curriculum changes in the department, that discussion comes, everybody brings their swords and so on because they are going to defend the field. That's where, you know, that's where this is, happened. Puerto Rico, I happen to, well, you know, I am from Puerto Rico, and for me, I consider myself Afro-Puerto Rican. But being in the U.S., you're prominently sort of Puerto Rican, or you're seen as Puerto Rican. And for me, that is what makes, you know, a big difference with all the process, even with Clinton. And it's like, you know, I come from a colonial territory of this state. Unless I hear someone somewhere radically denouncing, speaking, mobilizing, joining to end colonialism, then I cannot take you too seriously to begin with. And the same with anti-black racism, right? Unless you are really active, supporting Black Lives Matter, supporting, you're involved, you're risking some of your merits, you're doing that, I cannot take you, you know, too seriously either. Right? I mean, I know, this is, I laugh. You know, you laugh, you know that it's happening, and you keep doing your work. When some people appear that are willing to go there, you do coalitions, and you try to go there together. But that's about it. So I think that, you know, it's good to keep telling this the real story of the U.S. as a still form and engage in these forms of territorial possession of the traditional kind and vulgar kind of colonialism in addition. But you see, it's going to be removed. If black people can be killed in this country with the violence and proportion in your face, in your cities, and so on, why would you care about 4 million Puerto Ricans in an island in another place that you consider nowhere and whatever it is? So I don't have any hopes either that will do either, right?
I think the hope ended with 1954 when Lolita Lebron went to the Congress, no? And she said, free Puerto Rico, no? And then she was placed in jail, you know? Okay, I my family too, Chilean and Puerto Rican. Mm.
The one thing, good thing that Obama did, I mean, one of the good things he did when he left was that he liberated one of the long-standing Puerto Rican political prisoners. Oscar López Rivera. Yeah, he was like for 30 years in prison.
Campos, who was a Harvard University graduate, mm-hmm. as a supporter.
Yeah, Pedro Luis.
Second round of questions.
So one question I have is, I'm not in the humanities, I definitely enjoy and love them, but I'm actually the scientist. And so the problem we have there is that everything's an object. The merit of excellence is basically perfection or correctness. But as a result, I think the colonialism is even stronger. particularly around my colleagues, and the issues of post-racialness got swept up even higher because we're the sciences. We can't be racist in the science, either you're good or you're not. And so I guess I hear your argument, but without humanities present in the sciences, how do we deconstruct that, I guess, in that sense? When you're fighting from the basis of everything is already an object.
I kind of question on that too, because that's something I was questioning when you're talking about attacking this decolonization on a university level. But shouldn't we really be focusing on the curriculum that we're putting into our elementary schools and into our high schools on the history of how this country was made? Because I think that would probably be like the best solution, so then by the time we get to college, we don't have the mentality that we have of certain political issues and other stuff like that.
When they wanted to eliminate US American studies in 2011, that banned.
I want to throw out a slightly different narrative, not rationally different, but I'd like to see how you think through this. Faculty speak out all the time. We do it in the classroom. That's what we're trying to do. That's what we know how to do. We write for our colleagues. That's what we're told to do. That's how we get promotion. The fact that college graduates overwhelmingly voted against Trump says we did a good job with our assigned audience. So what I hear you saying, and please correct me if I misheard, is that we should be doing something else. That we should somehow be getting out of the university, being involved somehow more in the cultural discussions, and certainly those of us in humanities, you know, we're always being pushed to be more relevant, to be more of a public figure, to do public outreach, and so on. I think it applies less to sciences. I mean, I'm trying to sit here figure out how would the chemistry department do this. But that's not the topic of your talk, so that is. So can you elaborate a little bit on what does the university or higher education need to do differently to have the kind of impact that you are arguing for?
What we call now the natural sciences, before were part of the humanities, you know, they were not completely different. They were all sort of, or philosophia naturalis, it was seen as a form of philosophy, it was seen as a form of integral, it's an integral reflection. Because, I mean, you have to think about it, even when you say the natural sciences, what exactly is nature, and who is the one doing the investigation of nature? So those are definitions that require substantive engagement analysis, right? And so also there are concepts and ideas that you find versions, different ideas of what nature is. Nature is already a very loaded term to refer to, you know, it's so embedded we don't have any other words, but there are other words and other conceptions. But you see, however you conceive of that, which is called chemistry or biology and so on, will change depending on what is your conception of nature, the nature that you have, right? And your practices of research might change because of that. Not only in terms of the policy, but even in the very methods, how you approach the object into consideration, how you approach nature. And so Linda Smith wrote a book on decolonizing methodologies, and so she speaks about how for example, what would be for a Maori, from a Maori epistemology and perspective, that you don't see a division, you know, you don't see the sea as and sea life as something completely different to you, is part of the same habitat, environment, and you are linked to the sea in fundamental ways. Then how, if you are a scientist, what would it mean to the scientist as a Maori, right? How what would it be to do science and use mathematics and so on, but without the presumption that the Western conception of nature is the only dominant one, for example, right? So there are considerations for these kind of reflections within the so-called natural science. For mathematics, there are people who talk about the decolonization of mathematics, alleging that what has been formalized as mathematics in the West is hardly is strongly metaphysical, devoid of the practical aspects that some of the first mathematics in India and the Middle East they had, right? So what would it be to still think mathematics without that metaphysical prejudice, let's say? Or let's see what it gives us, but let's see also what it takes away. And there are people elaborating and writing about these things. One of them is C.K. Raju, R-A-J-U. So it is not, I don't think that the natural, you know, so-called natural sciences and mathematics are completely disconnected or devoid for many reasons, right? And this just being some examples. The school, of course, is the mechanism of the state, public schooling, to have everybody sort of ingrained into the same narrative of what is to be a citizen, that you are get acquainted and you feel that you belong and you are accepted and you embrace the spatio-temporal matrices of the nation state. So you accept the naturality of the borders, you accept the naturality of the timeline of the nation from the US Revolution until now. So public education particularly and pre-higher education, right, is fundamental for this. But the teachers that go there, oftentimes they come to the university to study because they come to schools of education. So you see, the higher education is not disconnected from public education because many of the teachers that go to teach in public education or in primary and secondary education, they have to get some degrees, university degrees. So they have to go to the university. And in the university is the space, the university and the technocrats in the departments of education, where they debate what is going to be the content of that, right, at a formal level. So it is very important to target those places where the decisions of what counts as legitimate material to teach in schools will be decided. Both at the public level, at the political level, right, education offices and so on, but also in colleges of education. But the material, what is taught in schools of education, for example, in areas of literature and culture, is tied to what humanists produce in the schools of arts and sciences, in humanities and culture. So you see, if what is produced here is already strongly colonized, that passes to the schools of education, that passes to public schools, that gets to the children come, they enter the school, it gets reinforced, and you see? So it has to be fought at every level. It has to be fought at every level. And since we are at the university and we are here, students and faculty, I'm raising the challenge as colleagues and students and so on to us. What does this mean to us? Because if we do not do it in our space, then doing the analysis and saying that, yes, it should be taking place everywhere, but you are in one of those places in the chain, then we don't go, you know. So the question would be, for example, what can you do as a student in the university to help this project get, you know, this kind of questioning continuing so that it can contribute to the larger struggle through the chain, right? And I think that it goes back to the right, asking the right questions, not taking assumptions from, you know, not taking your teacher's words for granted, doing additional research. Don't be conformed, don't conform yourself with the readings that you get in class. To the extent that you can, read more, engage more, take advantage of the libraries. If they don't have the books, or they read them, you know, the readings, order them through, you know, interlibrary loan, right? Part of the issue now with the neoliberalization, with the privatization of the university, is that students now have to dedicate more time working to pay for the education. Meaning that the extra time that they had, for example, I think if you, I mean, it wasn't in the university in the 60s or the 70s, but the people that I know from that era, they told me, you know, you could go to your classes, you could do all this, and you had time to, you know, time was key, and the time to think with your peers out of the classroom is fundamental. And out of that, that time was key for the movements that emerged in the 60s in universities and the movement against the war and so on. So one of the strategies to take one of the most groundbreaking, influential voices of insurgency critique in the US in the last 50 years, at least 70 years, which is the student body at universities, neoliberalism is trying to erode the possibility that of these kinds of action. Because now you, as individuals, you have to pay for your education, so even the idea of collectivity is lost, and then you don't have the time either. Maybe you have time to go to the movies, that's it, and then you have to go to work, right? You go to the party. The idea is that you, the free time that you have, you go to the fraternity, or you go to a place where fraternities, sometimes you can have more, you know, consistent engagements. But the part of what it's doing is that you no longer, as a body of people, youth, in that moment, crucial moment, in your lives, where you are, I think, have a unique lens to criticize, to criticize the models and the promises that have been made to you, right? And to criticize things that your parents see as problems, but they are already, you know, they already paying mortgage, they already tied with their lives, they cannot, but you have some more flexibility, right? This project, neoliberalism, is making sure that no, you are tied to your debt and your to paying, just like your parents are tied to their mortgage, and so nobody does anything. So how, in face of that, can you still do something? And how can the teachers, you know, that goes to the question of the teachers. This is the time that we live in. So I don't think that the, you know, traditional teaching in the class, using our areas of expertise to meet our opinions, are enough, because we have to think also, how do we, as people who are committed with the overall growth of our student body, then we help, we fight to provide them the best possibilities for them to develop the critical thinking. And we need to recognize that part of that is in the classroom, but also part of that is with what they do, with what we teach out of the classroom. Right? So already there is a fight there against neoliberalism that I see it as part of decolonization of thinking, that I think already puts a different layer. And this is not going outside the university to be activists and to the community. This is already inside the university itself. Right? This kind of other activism that we can do, organizing, link, you know, organizing with other faculty, and also organizing with students who are coming together. Right? But also, the other thing is this, the content of what we teach, the discipline in which we are, they are already deeply embedded with the very skewed criteria of knowledge that is so satisfied with thinking of our age as post-racial, for example. And that for a long time thought that things like Du Bois, when he writes in The Souls of Black Folk, he said, well, when the sociologist goes to the black neighborhoods, he goes there, you know, this is the humanistic mission of the sociologist, he's going to count how many drunk people are, how many prostitutes, he's going to count the pathology, right? And then you go to the university, and as a student, you learn the methodology of how to do that, how you become that. Or as an anthropologist, how you go back, you know, you go to the community and you, to the native informer, you're able to decode what they said into your, that's what we do. That's what I'm saying, is that it's a deeply colonial conceptualization of knowledge. And so, of course, when we teach it in class, our students come, they don't know a lot of things. And there is a level that equips them to teach, to think about the world critically, but up to a certain point. Up to a point where they could go against, yes, Trump, but they will be singing Clinton's praises. Right? Up to a point where they will, of course, oppose the vulgar racism and sexism. I mean, who in their good senses, I was hearing, but there are a lot of people. You know, that's very vulgar. I mean, that's the gravity of the situation, that kind of vulgar experience. Press, you know, racism, sexism has taken this level with the whole, you know, White House and the entire cabinet. So that's not difficult. That should not be too difficult to criticize. But what is it that allow someone like Trump and allow this perspective to be dominant for so long? I think that it was a self-satisfaction with the idea that we reached a post-racial era. That somehow, you know, and that's why Trump is incredible, this will not happen, and so on. And that is the kind of thing at training and that we need to change. And that's the kind of training that when you go to African studies, when you go to these places, there was no joke. We knew the world was already compromised, our world order, and it demanded stronger reaction since long ago. Think Obama. Obama should have been much more deeply criticized. Right? He was also deeply involved in this post-racial myth. And if the university students and faculty do not do that critique, who is doing it then? So I'm thinking of that more robust critique that coming from these spaces that has been have been created mainly by student activists, who now the neoliberalism is making impossible. So that's what I would put on the table.